Sometime back, the Los Angeles Times published a story of a flight cancellation at the city's main airport, which resulted in a long line of travelers trying to get booked on another flight. Waiting in the crowd was a rich businessman who grew impatient with a slow-moving line. He pushed his way to the front and angrily demanded that a first-class ticket be given to him on the next available flight right away. The woman at the counter said, "I am sorry, sir, but I will have to first take care of the people who were ahead of you in the line." The angry businessman pounded his fist on the counter and said to her, "Young lady, do you know who I am? Do you really know who I am?" Upon this, the ticket agent picked up the microphone and said, "Ladies and gentlemen, your attention please. Here is a man at the counter who does not know who he is. He is wearing a white shirt and a gray suit. He carries a small bag and had a lot of attitude. If there is anyone in the airport who can identify him, please come forward." On the 21st Sunday of the ordinary time, in the prescribed gospel passage, Matthew 16:13-20, Jesus asked his apostles the same question of the angry businessman. "Do you know who I am?" It is not because Jesus did not know who he was, but he wanted the apostles to know who he was, the Christ, and understand what this identity truly meant. The incident takes place in Caesarea Philippi, a Gentile city situated some 25 miles north of the Sea of Galilee. It had many pagan temples, including one to Caesar. The stop at Caesarea Philippi marked a transition point in the life of Jesus. His ministry to the public was over. Jesus now set his eyes towards Jerusalem, where he would be betrayed, crucified, and killed. But before all that could happen, he wanted to get his close associates on board regards who he was and what he came to the world for. To Jesus' question, Matthew 16:15, "Who do you say that I am?" Peter answered on behalf of all the apostles, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." The Greek word used here is Christos. Christos means the anointed one. Israel anointed people with oil to set them apart for a special role such as priest, prophet, or king. Anointing indicated not only that God had chosen this person, but also that God would give the person the ability to fulfill the role. But when Peter said, "You are the Christos," he was going one step further, a giant step. Israel had for many years been looking for God to send a savior, someone like King David of old. When Peter said, "You are the Christ," he was saying, "You are the Savior for whom we have waited for centuries. You are one sent from God to save us." Peter's confession put Jesus at the center of God's plan. The concept of Messiah obviously had a political ring to it. In the context of the oppressive Roman rule, which a majority of the Jews hated, the Christos they looked for was a warrior king who would lead Israel in a successful military campaign against the Romans, drive the foreign powers away, and restore the kingdom of Israel to its original place of pride as at the time of David. It is possible that the apostles too shared in such a view. This explains why later in chapter Matthew 16:21-23, Peter took Jesus away and rebuked when Jesus started saying things like getting betrayed and killed. Chapter 8, 32. This was not the kind of stuff that could happen to a Messiah. Verse 20 says, Jesus strictly ordered the apostles not to tell anyone that he was the Christ, because the apostles had to unlearn the concept of Messiah that they grew up with and learn the correct understanding of the Messiah as redefined and lived out by Jesus. Matthew 16:13-20 is not much about Jesus being proclaimed as the Christ, as about what it means for Jesus to be Christ and what it means for his followers to be Christians. For Jesus, to be Christ means to be a suffering servant of God. For his followers, to be Christians means to get behind Jesus, as Peter was told, and walk in his footsteps. The way of Jesus is the way of the Christians.